Chapter 1, The Other Kid at the Bad Brains Show. So, my first punk rock friend at high school had spiky hair, acne, and a pale Irish complexion. The most classically British, punk-looking New Yorker that I had ever met. His name was John Barry. Now, once we'd found each other, we'd get together, like, whenever we could, and we'd listen to new punk rock 7-inches. I remember hearing the Bad Brains, Pay to Come, sorry, the page sticks together, anyway. I remember hearing the Bad Brains, Pay to Come, and being totally blown away by it. It was faster than anything I had ever heard, but it was still a real song. It was pop enough that I loved it. We read everything we could find about punk rock and hardcore, which really wasn't much, but the Village Voice had an ad for a Bad Brains show at this place, the Botany Talk House, a tiny dive bar in Chelsea. That's the flag. Now, in our minds, Bad Brains were this huge fucking deal. But that night, there were maybe like 12 people there. And the only other kid, like, was like our age, was wearing a black trench coat, a couple of small homemade band buttons, and black combat boots. At that stage of my life, I was really, really shy. I mean, I wouldn't start a conversation with anybody, never mind a stranger. But John was much more comfortable socially than I was, so he just goes over, he starts talking to the kid, and it turns out his name was Adam Yauch. So, at this point, John Barry, myself, our friend Kate Schellenbach, we had already started our first band, and that was called The Young Aborigines. We practiced here, this is 100th Street and Broadway on the upper west side of Manhattan. We were up on this third floor. You know, Manhattan, you don't usually see rickety wooden buildings. San Francisco is different. New York City, not so much. Anyway, Yauch wasn't in the band, but he used to hang out with us all the time on 100th Street, which was great because he was the only one who actually knew how to do things. Technical things, like coiling up cables, like fixing a microphone with a soldering gun. He just magically knew how all these things worked. He had an understanding of things that, I don't know, it was things that I didn't even know I was supposed to know about. Pretty soon, Yauch was pushing us to start a separate side band. We already had the name for it, Beastie Boys. We were a button before we were a band. Of course, Yauch made this button, this actual button. That was another skill that he had. Now, the name stood for Boys Entering Anarchistic States Towards Inner Excellence. The acronym alone makes no sense, because boys is already in the title, and so the name is ridiculous and redundant. And also, we had a girl drummer, Kate. So anyway, our first gig was Yauch's birthday, August 5th, 1981. He was turning 17, I was still only 15. We still hadn't played a gig as Beastie Boys. So one day after practice, he motivates us all by saying, "Hey, let's have my birthday party at John's Loft and we'll play at it." So maybe 24 people showed up. Eventually we moved all of John's furniture, his bed, all this stuff, all the way against one wall, so we kind of had a dance floor. And then we got up the courage finally to put on our instruments and play. Then this guy, Dave Parsons, who ran our favorite record store and the place we'd hang out at called the Rat Cage, he comes up to us afterwards and says, "I got an idea. Why don't you guys make a record and I'll release it?" So now John, Kate, and Yauch and myself were hanging out all the time. We were making music, we're going to shows. Now along the way, we found other punk rock kids that became our friends. As soon, we evolved into a bigger clique of like-minded outcasts. So here's gonna be some Super 8 footage that we shot with our friends back in 1981. The Yowk, of course, cut together sometime later.
From the minors.
Yeah, it wasn't really, it's kind of more fact-based.
This is like 30-something years, we're still making this joke? So, when I joined the band, we would have practice at Yowk's house in Brooklyn. It was a beautiful old brownstone on a nice quiet street in Brooklyn Heights. We kept all of our equipment up in Yowk's room on the top floor. And after every show we played, we'd have to get everything back to Brooklyn and lug it all the way up to Adam's room on the top floor and do it without making a sound because his parents were asleep in their room just below his.
Now really, there's no way to be silent when you're carrying guitars and amps and drums and cymbals and stands and all this stuff. Especially if you're bringing up flights of creaky, really creaky stairs. And especially when it's being carried by a bunch of dumb-ass, loud teenagers who actually, we're thinking we're doing a great job of being quiet, and we truly believe that Yowk's parents are sound asleep. But, to their credit, we never heard a, "Yo, shut the fuck up!" from the second floor. Yowk's parents do not talk like that, just to be clear. But maybe Noel and Francis Yowk are just the heaviest sleepers of all sleepers ever, or more probably, they're just wonderful parents. That was...
So, at this point in 1983, we were still a punk band, but we love rap music. And Yowk's parents had an old friend that ran a recording studio. And he said we could use it for a night. So we went to the studio and we fucked around and we made a song called Cookie Puss. So, the idea behind our song Cookie Puss was that we were making fun of Malcolm McLaren's song Buffalo Gals. Now that song was massive in our circle and scene, the clubs of New York City, downtown 83. We actually loved Buffalo Gals, and we listened to it every day and danced to it every night, so why make fun of it? We had to. You see, it's tough for New York City kids to like or love anything. It's just not cool. Whatever you do, you have to show the outward appearance of, yeah, pizza's okay, you know, it tastes good, you know, but like, I've been eating pizza since back in the day, so, you know, whatever. So Cookie Puss came out, and then something we never thought would happen happened. Our friends started telling us that they heard DJs playing it in clubs. So things are changing for us now. It's not like we were a huge band or anything, but other people besides our 15 friends had heard our song. And one day I went to visit a friend at some weird temp job he had in high school, and we heard that Afrika Bambaataa was on some talk show on another floor in the building that we were at. And so we got fucking psyched, and we ran down, and we snuck onto the TV set. And this is what happened next.
I was just wondering, there's a song I really like called Cookie Puss by the Beastie Boys. I was wondering if you ever heard of it.
We rock movies, so.
Okay.
Yeah. You like that? Why do you like that one?
It's just a really funny song I heard on the radio.
Yeah, it's got scratching and work on it, like that.
It has a little bit of scratching on it, and it's funky. Uh-huh.
You want to be sprinkled?
Yeah. All right.
Is that a request?
All right. Chapter 2, hip hop goes downtown.